Well, I want to thank you all for coming here. This is the second lecture in a four-part series of lectures on freedom. They're called Freedom, Text, and Context, because simultaneous with each of these lectures, there will be an exhibit over at the Museum of Texas Tech. Early and first edition classic texts dealing with the freedom explored in the lecture. The exhibit on religious freedom will be opening tomorrow. Actually, I think the first day that the public can go see it is Friday, May 6th, but there will be a ceremony tomorrow, formally opening up the exhibit. I'd like to therefore also thank the Remnant Trust, whose president, Chris Vex, is here among us. And I'd like to thank the museum, and I'd also like to thank most profusely and deeply the CH Foundation, whose generous grant has made this entire lecture series and the exhibit as well possible. Freedom depends on tolerance. If each is to be free to choose, others must accept their choice. Not agree with it, necessarily, but accept the right to make. And this will sometimes require the gritting of teeth. Freedom does not require affirmation. To the extent affirmation is required, freedom ceases. Not that affirmation is bad, to the extent that affirmation is freely offered. To the extent such affirmation extends itself naturally over many areas of a society's life, freedom comes to that society more easily. But in any complex society, there will be many areas in which there is no consensus, and some in which there is serious disagreement. These don't call for affirmation of difference, but for something much harder, and that's called toleration. Toleration can have many useful applications. Our subject today is its religious dimension. Once that meant a dominant religion, that is to say, a religion with state support, tolerating other religions. This was very hard. Should you tolerate a road to damnation for helpless souls? Wouldn't it be better to lead them from error to salvation? For ages, that was the common wisdom. It was only through centuries of struggle, indeed bloodshed, that this common wisdom got changed. And the country in which that change was most fully expressed was our own, the one that gloried in the First Amendment to its Constitution. And it is precisely because America was so pluralistic, so diverse, that this toleration was essential. It held together the social and political fabric of a society in which there were many ethnic and religious groups, and therefore much potential fuel for everything. Today, religious toleration is under growing attack, and not just with respect to one particular religion. What is in question today is something closer to the toleration of religion itself, at least where religious belief and practice runs counter to a new secular triumphalism that sees traditional morality and religion that espouse it as flawed, exclusive, and iniquitous. More and more, one senses a return of the ancient nostrum that error has no rights. It is our speaker and not me, lest I tread too far into his terrain, who has the depth of knowledge concern to do this court subject justice. Jared Bradley is one of America's leading authorities on the law and history of religious freedom in America. He is professor of law at the University of Notre Dame, where he teaches legal ethics and constitutional law. He also co-directs the Natural Law Institute and co-edits the American Journal of Jurisprudence. As you can see, he shares this. Professor Bradley has been a visiting fellow at the Hoover Institution of Stanford University and a senior fellow at the Witherspoon Institution of the Witherspoon Institute in Princeton, New Jersey. For many years, he served as president of the Fellowship of Catholic Scholars. Among his most recent books is The Challenge to Religious Liberty in the 21st Century, which was published by Cambridge University Press in 2012, and now is in need of updating, because things are moving quickly. We are honored to have him here today, and it is my pleasure to introduce Professor Bradley.
Steve Balch said that affirmation, or as you say, freedom doesn't need affirmation, and he went on to say that affirmation, when freely given, nonetheless is valuable. I think it works much the same way with gratitude. If gratitude is forced or insincere, it's not really gratitude, and it's really phoniness. So I want to offer then a sincere word or two of gratitude to Steve for organizing not only my lecture, with my entire 2 days here in Lubbock, which is off to a whirlwind start today, but also for his valuable work on behalf of the Institute, or with the Institute and the entire lecture series and other range of activities that he's organized here. I think it's a remarkable accomplishment in the 3 or 4 years that he's been here. So thank you, Steve Balch, and all the others of you who made this possible, including the CH Foundation for sponsoring the activity. And thank you to all of you for coming. I won't go into the fact that some of you students may be here under duress, and your professors may be in attendance. And deprived of the opportunity to say that I'm deeply gratified that you chose to come hear me rather than to have dinner, since Steve has seen to that, providing dinner along with my lecture. But nonetheless, I'm very grateful to see so many of you come out and hear what I have to say, my attempt to make sense, that Steve also says, a very, very rapidly changing, evolving, but still challenging framework, a set of questions concerning religious liberty in our time. And it really is quite improbable that I'm here. I mean, for one thing, I left the center of the political universe just yesterday to come here. That would be Indiana, where we voted in the primary. I voted in the primary yesterday afternoon, and then got on an airplane. And by the time I got here last evening, I discovered Trump had won, Cruz is out, and it looks like Trump is the candidate. So things happen very quickly in Indiana, especially when I'm not there.
But Bobby Knight was there.
Yeah, Bobby Knight was an ill-tempered basketball coach who went from Indiana to Texas Tech, right? And I trust he didn't throw very many chairs when he was coach at Texas Tech. But that's a different lecture. I could talk about Bobby Knight, maybe during the question and answer period. I actually watched Bobby Knight coach. I grew up in New York City. I'll return to that in a second. And I had a brother who went to West Point. But Bobby Knight was the coach of Army's basketball team many years ago. So I observed Bobby Knight coaching when he was about 30 years old. But I did discover, I've known Steve Balch for a while, but I didn't know until today when we were talking that this improbable thing has happened. Here are two guys from Brooklyn, New York, in Lubbock, kind of running the show. And who could figure that, right? Steve and I are a few years apart, but we have a lot of common memories of Brooklyn. And I've been living in the Midwest for 30 years now. But I did make it clear to Steve that I'm delighted to be in Lubbock, and I've met wonderful people during the time I've been here. But I am still basically a New Yorker, and I don't do barbecue, and I'm not going to the rodeo with you, Steve. So far, I've gotten my way. But I do want to turn to the topic at hand, because as I say, I think important in its own right or on its own terms. But I think the topic of religious liberty is of more than perennial interest insofar as right now I think we're facing a set of challenges unlike any of those that have come before. And I want to preface my remarks lastly before I go to my prepared remarks by saying that during the course of my remarks I'll be making some observations which have to be considered frank criticisms of the way things are, especially in our law today. But lest you think I'm just a whiner or a complainer, I should say that there's a lot to celebrate in our regime or our order of religious liberty. And in addition to that, I think America looking at it in the whole sweep of the 2+ centuries of our history, and even up to today, is a remarkable success story when it comes to freedom of religion. Not to say the record is flawless, or that there aren't challenges right now, because I think there are serious challenges. But when you look at the sweep of history and look at the possibilities explored in other countries, warts and all, I think our experiment in religious liberty has been, by the standards of the real world and the way history has gone, I think a roaring success. So if you take my remarks in the spirit of continuing and building upon that success, maybe it'll go down a little bit better. But let me say that many people say that religious liberty in our country is now under attack as never before. That's true as far as it goes, and these remarks include some reasons why I think it's under attack as never before. But my chief aim today is not to persuade you that it's worse than ever, according to some common metric, as if to establish that what's happening now registers higher on the scale than the measurements, say, for American Indians, that is, Native Americans, who over the century between their final settlement on reservations and passage of the American Indian Religious Freedom Act in 1978, they endured countless denials of their religious liberty. And I don't mean to suggest or try to argue that it's lower today, according to some measurement, than it was, let's say, for the Latter-day Saints, whose church Uncle Sam literally scattered to secure the Mormons' renunciation of plural marriage near the end of the last, or I should say, blend of the 19th century. By some obvious measures or metrics, these episodes are worse than what's happening now. Nevertheless, by some other obvious metrics, what's happening now is, I think, worse than ever. That is one reason why I shall attend a bit more in my talk to these historical episodes about LDS and Native Americans to indicate the magnitude of the present challenge. But the main reason is to put what's happening today in bold relief, to show how what's happening today is radically different in kind, more than in degree, than what happened with the LDS, Latter-day Saints, and the Indians. Of course, what happened then happened to particular groups, particular sects, particular churches. Each of the two, insular, geographically isolated, and with no footprint in the wider society. What's happening now is happening on Main Street, and it's happening to mainstream believers. And it's happening to religion. Although traditional Christians are the ones most often put to the test now, when their religious rights or their conscience hits them and puts them in conflict with, for example, same-sex marriage, they are casualties in a wider war. Americans today are engaged in an unprecedented contest over the meaning and value of religious liberty. The trajectory of this fight or this argument or engagement points to effects much more sweeping and more foundational than anything that's happened before in our country. Now, I'm speaking not just of effects upon believers, vast as those effects might be, because Americans have always had a robustly religious culture and prized religious freedom as their first freedom. The path we are on will eventually, unless it changes, transform our whole political culture. Now, I think there is just one historical precedent for something like what's happening now. And I think that precedent is instructive, although far from exactly like or sitting on all fours with what's happening now. It is our nation's encounter with Roman Catholicism. More exactly, our nation's treatment of Roman Catholics between the Civil War and about World War I. But I'll say more about the encounter with Catholics a little bit later. But first, in which ways were the depredations against Native Americans and the LDS, Latter-day Saints, more egregious than the challenges today? Well, today's attacks are nonviolent. Kim Davis, the county clerk in Kentucky, some of you probably have heard of her travails. Kim Davis likely would be followed by some other believers into custody before too long. But there's not going to be a wounded knee in this story or this engagement. Both Indian and Mormon travails were protracted, measured in decades. We do not know yet how long the current crucible will last. And I would date the onset of the red-hot phase of today's challenging engagement with religious liberty only to the last several years. I think something that started in the last 5, 6, 7 years, and probably continuing on for another 5, 6, 7 years, is really a white-hot period of engagement and challenge to religious liberty. For what it's worth, I think right now, and perhaps especially in light of the bathroom wars that you might have read about in North Carolina, we're actually in the grip of an especially almost feverish sort of engagement between sexual identity and religious freedom, which I think engagement will subside, the temperature will go down, things will not be quite so white hot or feverish for too much longer. And although not exactly a measure of religious intolerance, both the LDS and the Native Americans were beleaguered minorities in an indifferent, if not hostile, wider American society. Now, those holding to a biblical morality today face steep challenges, but they're not total outliers. They're not isolated small groups, as were the Mormons and the Native Americans. Now, I just should add, by the way, with regard to the case of the LDS, I don't myself think that government suppression, or at least discouragement of plural marriage, such as it was, is in itself unjust, even when the practice of plural marriage is rooted in religious belief, as it was for LDS. So again, I don't think that the government's attempts to discourage, and maybe even to suppress plural marriage, were themselves just as such wrong. But our federal government pursued that objective by unjust means. Those means included statutes, you know, congressional laws, which effectively made Mormons an outlaw people and their church a criminal conspiracy. The federal law, which was upheld by the Supreme Court in 1890 in a case called Davis v. Beeson, stripped not only those who were polygamists of the right to vote and hold public office. That's one thing that law did. But that law also disqualified from voting and holding public office anyone who belonged to any association which taught that anyone could enter a plural marriage. So the short of it is the government disenfranchised and basically eliminated the civil rights of all Mormons because they belonged to the LDS Church and it was over polygamy. Now I think sound government policy would not have accorded legal status to plural marriages and would have taken reasonable steps to discourage it. But something like an uneasy tolerance would have been preferable to the nuclear option which the government chose to use in the 19th century against the Mormons. Then again, the government's scorched earth policies were more an attempt, I think, to subdue the stubbornly independent Mormon people that the government in Washington was trying to establish effective political control over the Mormons in the West, then they were really meaning to eradicate plural marriage. Now, in the late 19th century, the government, the federal government, Uncle Sam, I say, regarded those people who lived on the Native American reservations as wards of the government. That's the way the government thought of the Native Americans on the reservations. And by any measure, the Indians were then dependent on government support to get by on the reservations. Because on the reservations now in the late 19th century, much of their traditional way of life was no longer tenable. The way the Indians had lived when they were free to roam the plains, for example, was no longer tenable. And the government's policies towards the Native Americans was basically this. On or off the reservation, the only alternative to forcibly assimilating the Indians to the American mainstream was, according to the people who made government policy in those days, continued isolation and atrophy of the Indians on the reservations. Now, maybe there's some truth to that judgment, and maybe there's some truth in the further judgment, which was certainly the viewpoint of the federal authorities dealing with Indians in the late 19th century. They thought that tribal culture, as well as certain aspects of Indian religion, were really impeding this needed assimilation of the Indian people to the mainstream culture. So what people would say in those days, and you could say it in polite company about the Indians and federal policy towards them, was that the Indians needed to be deprived of their communistic tribal ways and their pagan religion. Well, maybe that's what people said. And maybe there were things to regret in Native American religion, because I think there were. Some aspects of Native American religion were not sound. But it's more important in retrospect to observe that ambient disrespect for Indian religion spilled over into disrespect for Indian people. And disrespect for Indian people's rights to decide for themselves what to believe and to profess, even if what they would affirm seemed to leave them in an unassimilated condition. So they put that plainly. I think the great criticism of government policy towards Native Americans was not that the government or people involved in government thought Native American ways were not healthy, or the Native American religion may not have been sound. And certainly Native American religion was very different than mainstream Christianity. That could all be true, and I think largely was true. But that doesn't mean you don't respect people's religious freedom. People have a right to decide for themselves how to organize their religious worldview, even if it's a worldview that you yourself don't credit. So that was, I think, at the heart of the government's mistake in treating American Indians the way they did. It's also much the way they treated Roman Catholics, Catholic immigrants to this country. According to mainstream Protestantism, which informed federal policy to a great extent, was that Catholicism was an unhealthy, if not simply deviant, form of Christianity. And that Catholicism was not only deviant, but it was a kind of Christianity that was not suited to American democratic practices and institutions. In short, the view of Catholics was that they couldn't really become real American citizens unless they stopped being Catholic and became much more like Protestants. So there was a view about the need to assimilate Roman Catholics to the mainstream. And it's in some ways parallel to the view of religion, Native American religion. Now here, I think there's one more comparison to make to the Mormon case, the LDS case. The LDS had a very strange view from the mainstream perspective, a very strange religious viewpoint. The cosmology of Mormonism is not like Christian cosmology. And it struck mainstream believers as just bizarre. But I think that LDS members and Mormons operated, apart from their religious beliefs, in a very secular way in the everyday world. So that the wellspring of hostility to LDS church members actually was not their unwillingness to assimilate. It was, I think, in the end, their unwillingness to accept effective government authority from Washington. Now, one big part of how the government violated Indians' religious liberty consisted of government actions intended to keep the Catholic Church off as many reservations as possible, precisely to impede the Indians' access to the Catholic faith. Now, the gravest, and on any account of it, simply indefensible, incursion on Indian religious liberty was denying parents their right to direct the upbringing of their children, especially with regard to their religious upbringing. Indian children often were separated, sometimes forcibly, from their parents and sent to Christian boarding schools. For a time at the turn of the century, meaning around 1900, the stated government policy was that because Indians were wards of the government, government officials and not parents would decide which schools Native American children would attend. And the effects upon Indian families were heart-wrenching. Now let's talk about now, though. What about now? By some obvious measures, or metrics I call it, what's happening now is worse than even back then. And I want to say a little bit about how the challenge we're facing is graver, that is more serious, than the challenges faced by LDS and American Indians. Well, for one thing, the numbers of people, to be Mormons and Native Americans, who were affected back then were few. Even Catholics were just a respectable minority. And I say respectable meaning there weren't very many of them in number, not that they were respectable socially, which they weren't. The denominations and churches, on the other hand, the denominations and churches, which until about a generation ago held that abortions should never be done, that a same-sex couple could never marry. But a generation ago, about 90% of America's churchgoers thought both of those things, that abortion should not be performed, and that a same-sex couple couldn't marry. To this minute, probably about half of churchgoing Americans hold these positions, not just as a matter of a good rule to follow, a good rule of thumb, but as truths of morality. Now, the cutting edge of conflict with the Mormons in the 19th century was small and precise. Abandoning plural marriage was a recognized terminal point of the government's program, the obvious price of peace. This was not quite true of Native Americans, although some naive people back then thought that this assimilationist project, bringing Native Americans into the mainstream of American society, would take just one generation. Basically, the idea was if you yank Indian children from their parents, put them in government schools, then they would be the next generation of Indian parents, and things would be fine. I think that was naive. And they thought the same way about Catholics. Get Catholics into public schools, and before you know it, they'll be like Protestants. But all things considered, I think the Indian case was a unique situation, a perfect storm of factors, a one-off thing, and it bred or subsisted on mutual hostility, prejudice, and maybe some good intentions gone awry. It's not likely to be repeated. The episode of Native Americans, I think, was unique in American history. The other difference is that the LDS and the Native Americans basically interacted with only the national government, Uncle Sam, the federal government, D.C. But today, the issues that are confronting us, confronting especially believers in biblical morality, don't just involve the federal government, but state and local government as well. Now, it makes a difference whether the federal government is passing a national law which impacts negatively believers as opposed to one of the states. But altogether today, with all three levels of government involved in a struggle over religious liberty, that is national, state, and local government, that makes it very different now, and the crisis much broader and graver than it was in the 19th century, where it was only Mormons and Native Americans in the federal government. One more thing that I think is different, that indicates another reason why today the challenge is greater than in the 19th century. Neither the Mormons nor the Indians maintained large-scale institutions of health care, education, and charity. Now, I don't mean to say anything negative or apply anything negative here about the web of care within the communities of Mormons and Native Americans. This is to say, these were very tightly knit communities of people, where those communities were full of mutual assistance. But what I'm talking about now is different. Christians, and especially Catholics, have thrown up huge institutional networks, hospitals, colleges, schools, and charities, which are maintained not just for the internal benefit of Catholics or Christians, but are parts of civil society. So that the challenge to religious freedom today challenges the continuing existence and flourishing of all of these huge institutions, hospitals, charities, and schools, which play a role not only in the internal life of the Christian community or Catholic community, but in the society at large. But now the camel's nose is under everyone's tent. Now. The butcher, the baker, and the candlestick maker can all try to run from being forced to be complicit in something they find morally objectionable, but they can't hide. People in commerce, people involved in huge institutional ministries like hospitals and colleges, they have a public profile and public activities that prevent them from hiding from the law. The law will find them and oblige them, the way things are going, to be complicit in activities that they regard to be immoral. So Christian moral life is threatened, you might say, by complicity in even one obnoxious act. So to put it plainly, typically you might say Christians believe that, not that they shouldn't be involved in very many abortions or be involved in very many same-sex marriage, but Christians typically or often believe that I can't be involved in any such thing, or I can't be involved in any case of the death penalty or any case of torture. So Christians often, if not typically, believe that being made to be involved in even one morally wrong act kind of scuttles the whole moral life. So they're especially sensitive to being made to participate in something they regard as morally obnoxious. Put it a little bit differently, for Christians and for many other believers, as well as some non-believers, head-on collision with one legally required, morally obnoxious duty, whether, just for example, to certify a candidate to be euthanized, to certify someone to be euthanized, which right now is a brewing crisis in Canada, by the way, or to pay for one abortion, or to return one guilty verdict in a death penalty case, or to dispense one prescription of an abortifacient drug, or to morally ratify or promote one same-sex wedding, one case threatens the moral integrity of these sorts of believers. So on a grander scale, for example, several Catholic agencies have decided to close rather than comply with laws which require the agency to place kids for adoption with same-sex couples. So here's where I think we're standing and looking down the pike at what the challenge facing us is shaping up to be. And I'll say more to explain this, but I'm going to use a quotation from Justice Sam Alito, which came in the same-sex marriage decision case last June. And I'm going to use it as my take-off point to talk about the nature of the challenge today and what we can do about it. So I'm going to read a quote from Alito and basically explain it as we go along. But just as Alito wrote in Obergefell, which is the name of the case for same-sex marriage, he said, "Those who cling to old beliefs will be able to whisper their thoughts in the recesses of their own home. But if they repeat those views in public, they will risk being labeled as bigots and treated as such by governments, by employers, and even by their schools." That's what Alito says. And again, that those who cling to the old moral beliefs will be able to whisper their thoughts at their homes or in their homes, but repeating those views in public invites recrimination. But wait. I've been talking as if the question is, how are we going to compare one-to-one what happened in the 19th century and what's happening now? As if I'm trying to, in the end, find a common metric by which to judge it was worse then, according to some metrics, but worse now, according to some other metrics. And I want to abandon that way of thinking. I don't think we can grasp what we're facing by thinking in such terms of a one-to-one comparison. I think something more troubling or important is happening. I've described so far what I think are surface manifestations of the challenges afoot or at hand. But I think they're surface manifestations of transformative forces beneath our social life. That what we're talking about so far, whether adoption agencies close, whether people can speak out loud their own moral beliefs in public, whether the butcher, the baker, and the candlestick maker can avoid complicity in a same-sex wedding. Those are very important matters, but I think that's the surface of what's happening. Those manifest forces underneath. It's like those things are the audible sounds of tectonic plates shifting under our social life. Down below these things is the epicenter of today's unprecedented challenge to religious liberty. Down below is an emerging, largely coherent, pretty well thought out, I think growing way of looking at religion, its meaning and value, and religious liberty, its meaning and value. And I think that transformation belief is what we should watch. It's a matter of keeping your eye on the ball or on the action. So let me explain what I mean. And here I'll try to describe exactly what I think is happening beneath these more visible manifestations. So I'll do something that I'm a law professor. This is what law professors love to do. We love to string together quotations from judges. We think it amounts to knowledge, which some people would dispute. But I'm going to use some illustrations. I'm going to illustrate my point by using some quotations from judges to try to get across to you what I think is happening beneath the surface and causing the surface manifestations we're talking about. So here's one example. Justice Anthony Kennedy, in the Hobby Lobby case from a couple of years ago, had to do with the Health and Human Services mandate about contraception. In Hobby Lobby, it's a Christian, well, you know what Hobby Lobby is, that the Christian family owns it. And they managed to convince the court, in light of relevant federal law, that they had a kind of religious liberty right not to be made to pay for the contraception and abortive fashions for their employees as part of this health care thing. So in Hobby Lobby, Justice Kennedy said that the free exercise of religion is essential to preserving the dignity of those who choose to strive for a self-definition shaped by their religious precepts. So free exercise of religion, according to Justice Kennedy, is essential for those who strive for a self-definition shaped by religious precepts. Now, this same idea anchors Kennedy's opinion in the same-sex marriage case. Kennedy said in the same-sex marriage case, the right to marry dignifies couples who wish to define themselves by their commitment to each other. Now, in 1992, I know to you, to most of the young people here, it seems like a century ago, but in a case involving abortion rights, Justice Kennedy wrote as far back as 1992 that a woman's decision about abortion originates in a zone of conscience and belief and must be settled by her own self-defining spiritual imperatives. Now, what I think the pattern developing here is where Kennedy is talking about all sorts of choices, including choices about religion, all as aspects of self-definition. Now here I want to add not a judicial quotation, but something that then Senator Barack Obama said in 2006, which makes him sound a bit like Justice Kennedy. Then Senator Obama described religion as each one's narrative arc, which relieves a chronic loneliness. Religion provides an assurance that somebody out there cares about them, is listening to them, and Obama said, that they are not just destined to travel down that long highway to nothingness. This is Senator Obama, like 10 years ago. That religion, he said, is an assurance that somebody out there cares about them and is listening to them. They are not just destined to travel down that long highway to nothingness. Now, this religion sounds very much like what Justice Kennedy says about marriage, said about marriage last June. Kennedy said that marriage responds to the universal fear that a lonely person might call out, only to find no one there. Now, I think that these converging ways of viewing the exercise of civil liberties about marriage, abortion, sexual activity, and religion. All of them becoming aspects of self-definition is the thing to watch. Let me put it this way. In 1992, Justice Kennedy wrote, in a case involving abortion rights, that the heart of liberty is the right to define one's own concept of existence, of meaning, of the universe, and of the mystery of human life. Again, the heart of liberty is the right of each person to define one's own concept of existence, of meaning, of the universe, and the mystery of human life. I think that religious liberty is right before our eyes disappearing into this wider liberty. That's my submission. It's been a long run-up, but that's what I suggest to you. That there's one liberty, the right to self-definition, to create for oneself one's own sort of mental universe. Within the big liberty, there are subdivisions or smaller liberties that have to do with marriage, sex, abortion, and religion. What I suggest to you is that religious liberty has become just one subset or one subdivision of this huge one, this unified liberty. And I think that's going to remap our social world. That's going to change our social world. And let me conclude with why I think that, what this new social world will look like, and why I think that's what's happening. And then we're going to have questions and answers and argument, and we'll see if there's any food left. But this is my thesis, that religious liberty is no longer standing on its own distinct ground, but is disappearing into, being gobbled up by, or is going into this encompassing right of self-definition. So the boundary lines of the new social world divide human activity into two basic realms. There's only two realms in the new world. The first is public life, defined very broadly to include not only law and political affairs, but also all aspects of commerce and the marketplace, the worlds of public accommodation, buying and selling. But the public world is not just law and politics, the public square, but all aspects of commercial life. That's public. This huge space, I think, is governed by a secular orthodoxy from which only mental reservation is going to be permitted. Here's where I think Justice Alito is basically right. The concurring judge in one case involving a wedding photographer in New Mexico, came up against a requirement that that person do the wedding pictures for a same-sex couple. This is the one way to grasp this new public realm, one of the two realms in the new world. The judge in that case is called Elaine Photography, said, Elaine, who's the photographer, the Christian photographer, she's free to think, to say, to believe what she wishes. She may pray to the God of her choice and follow God's commandments in her personal life. But in public space, this judge went on to say, believers like Elaine must compromise, for that's the price of citizenship. So conscience rights come up against the requirements of citizenship, allegedly, and compromise is required by a decent regard for being a good citizen. In this new public realm, religion may still supply motivation for some people, and a common stock of phrases and images for many more. So many politicians, even in the new world, including President Obama, will talk about what a beautiful day the Lord has made, or use other public religious imagery. That will continue. Motivation and imagery will still populate the public realm. But I think that's about it. I don't think in the public order of the near future, religion will be a recognizable set of reasons for acting. So what do I mean by that? In the same 2006 talk about religion, then Senator Obama explained how democracy demands that the religiously motivated translate translate their concerns into universal values. The reasons, he said, were two. Religion does not allow for compromise, and it is not subject to argument or reason. Now, I'm not just picking on Obama because he's a very important person, but I think here, although he is an important person, but here I think his views are representative of what I'm describing as the foundations for a new way of thinking about religion and public life. Again, that religion is not a matter of reason, not subject to compromise, so that it can't be used in public life as a basis for arguing about what the law should be. Now, religion has to be prioritized. Obama said, to base one's life on such uncompromising commitments may be sublime, but to base our policy on such commitments would be a dangerous thing. Now, the safe place, safe space for religion in the new world is the private sphere. The private sphere. But religion in the private sphere is subsumed within each one's project of individual self-definition. In the private sphere, religion is free. But in the private sphere, religion is assimilated to the conscience or dignity or the identity of the acting person. One legal philosopher aptly wrote, and I'll quote this philosopher, in this way of viewing things, religion's status and its properties are as instances of the only really basic human good, the only intrinsically worthwhile end at stake, which is setting for oneself one's stance in the world. This whole private area is about will and imagination. The foundation of value in this private realm is not the truth about what there is, but authenticity, that each person's worldview be really theirs. Whether or not the worldview is true doesn't matter. So in the new world, religion is a component of a person's identity and has to do with making up the identity of some persons. And it has no traction on our public life, our common life. Now here's one big difference then between then and now. The difference between then and now affects those who believe, but also everyone who engages the religious question, even those who don't believe. Which is to say, almost everybody engages the religious question. What is life about, and why am I here? Is there a divine reality? The question that's going to affect everybody, even non-believers, but those who are interested in the religious question, in our new social world, people wonder, what is this religious quest about? What is the substance of this thing called religion? Is it about me and my dreams, my depths? Or is it about reality, visible and invisible? Is religion about the truth about reality? Now, it seems likely to me that the meaning and value of religious liberty will depend in our society and any place else on the meaning and value of religion. And the meaning and value of religion, I submit to you, is now being transformed into not some idea or account of divine reality, but rather it's about me, my worldview. Now, I indicated earlier that while people can be, and in America have been, free to decide what to believe about religion, it's not the same for what I would call the metaphysics of religion. Individuals, and even whole churches, religious congregations, they don't choose to define the nature of what religious belief is about. I think culture supplies that. So again, people can choose to believe what Methodists teach, or Catholics teach, or Buddhists teach, or Mormons teach. As if you can, you know, call up what those churches have on offer and decide which way fits you. But I don't think people, you know, individually or even in groups, can sort of constitute reconstitute for themselves what all of that is about. I think the culture is going to be telling us more and more that religion is about your spirituality. It's about who you are. It's not about what God is really like, or even whether there really is a God, and what God's relationship to the world is. So, vocabularies of self-definition and self-fulfillment, identity, stalk today's believers. That conception of religion as a matter of identity, authenticity, self-definition, already is the controlling definition of religion in our law. I think it's the controlling definition across the board in the academy, in the universities, and in much, but far from all, of popular religion, religion in the marketplace. It's even found its way into traditional churches. There's a cultural critic named Philip Reif who wrote in 2005 that the Orthodox believers are in the miserable situation of being Orthodox for therapeutic reasons. And this vocabulary of self-fulfillment and identity, which is overtaking our understanding of religion, I think it's the main reason, not the only reason, but the main reason why the non-church of those who are spiritual but not religious is the fastest growing denomination in America, which I think it is. That the census tracts and other data indicate that the fastest growing group of people, at least religion-wise, is those who are spiritual but not religious. And I think that what I'm talking about helps explain that. See, each person's experience is the measure of his or her religion, and not the other way around. So if you think of religion as a matter of my identity and self-fulfillment, and you think of it in therapeutic terms, I think belonging to a church is certainly dispensable, and probably even an impediment to realizing that uniquely, authentically me that constitutes my religion. Now, this whole turn in religion and our understanding of it, I think, makes religion, understood as an account of what there is, religion understood as an account of the nature of reality and about divine reality, I think it makes that way of viewing religion, you know, almost practically inaccessible to people. As Philip Reif says, even the Orthodox are trapped in vocabularies of self-fulfillment. Now, one immediate legal effect of religion's turn inward to me, to identity, is that conscientious religious objectors who feel themselves guided, if not commanded, by a transcendent source of meaning and value, now come into view as very strange-looking people, and even egotistical. So again, the point is that in this view of religion, Christians and others who object to being involved in abortion or the death penalty or torture, whatever the example is, and who say, I can't do that, my beliefs really forbid me from being involved in that activity, that becomes very hard to understand if you're thinking of religion in these alternative terms as self-fulfillment and self-expression. And people who hold fast to these moral requirements will begin to appear to be almost fanatical and at least egotistical. Now, an English judge, a law judge, his name happened to be Law, so the law judge named Law, gave a very nice summation expression, a summary expression to all that I'm trying to describe here. So I'm going to read what he said in an opinion involving a case in which a Christian relationship counselor was dismissed from her job. She didn't want to counsel people to be promiscuous, is what it came down to. But here's what Judge Law said about whether there could be an exemption from legal requirements about treating and counseling all comers for a Christian counselor. The judge said, any exemption on religious grounds would be unprincipled because it would give effect to the force of subjective opinion. Which he meant religion, his subjective opinion, and thus could not advance the general good on objective grounds. So finally then, after this long march through the sort of setup of things and the foundations of what we can see, the substratum of ideas manifesting themselves on the surface. Religion is private, it is subjective. Public life is objective and real. It's not about ideas concerning me and who I think I am, that's public, not in public. The private life is where persons invent themselves. Some people invent themselves on religious bases and some don't. So this, I submit to you, is the new social map, I call it, the way of dividing up the world. And this turn to a therapeutic view of religion, I think, will undermine, hollow out, or render vulnerable all claims of religious liberty in our society. Again, it's not a matter, as it was 100 plus years ago, of treating some believers very badly. And make no mistake about it, the Indians and the Mormons, among others, were treated very badly. We're talking now about a way of reconfiguring religion which will lead to differences in how we treat everybody. The meaning of religion for everybody, at least as a cultural and legal matter, is being changed. So finally, let me say a few things about why I think this matters a lot, besides perhaps the apparent appeal that anybody can see, that, well, this is a bad thing if you're a big believer in religious liberty. I think that's one thing. But I want to say just three things about how other parts of our common life will be affected, I think negatively, by this turn in the meaning of religious liberty, and then I'll be done. I'll take questions. So three transformations worked by the subjectivist turn in religious liberty, which these transformations don't themselves have exactly to do with religious liberty. Call this collateral damage. One, from the founding of our country until, well, a few days ago, I suppose, recently, Americans believed that our experiment in liberty depended in some essential way upon the religiosity of the people. That our experiment in liberty depended upon a virtuous people. And one of the keys to virtue, if not the key to virtue, was religious belief. This is, for those of you in the government department, now or once before, or who studied the founding, but this is Federalist 10, it's Washington's farewell address, you can see it in Lincoln. It's in countless political speeches, election sermons, popular essays by persons of all faiths, and even persons of no faith, you know, up until probably the 1960s. Tocqueville, for example, wrote that religion should be considered the first of America's political institutions, a sentiment which has reverberated throughout American history. Now, in the old days, in the 19th century, Protestantism was the template for this religion which would undergird the experiment in liberty. But Protestantism, as the template, was broken mainly by Roman Catholics by around the early 20th century. And after World War II, what was commonly called the Judeo-Christian tradition, or tri-faith America, Protestant, Catholic, Jew, became the religious substratum of American political liberties. And even during the Cold War, the 50s into the 60s, there was a special emphasis upon America's religious and political identity. Yes, President-elect Dwight Eisenhower really did say in 1952 at the Waldorf Astoria Hotel in New York City, he'd been elected president, he'd been inaugurated, but Dwight Eisenhower really did say, our form of government has no sense unless it is founded in a deeply felt religious faith, and I don't care what it is. Well, that's a ham-handed way of saying religion is somehow an essential support for our political institutions. And it doesn't matter what doctrines, whether it's a Trinity or the Unitarian view, whether you think Christ was an incredibly gifted moral teacher, whether you believe in Judaism's final points, whether you're Orthodox, Reform, or conservative in Judaism, it doesn't matter. But religion was an essential support of our polity. Now, this whole notion that public well-being depends upon private virtue, I think that's repudiated. I think that's gone. Henceforth, it is to be conformity in public. That citizenship means compromise and doing what the law requires. I think it's conformity in public, carnival in private. That, I think, is the price, but also the rewards of citizenship. Second, religious liberty has always been an indelible fixture of our political culture, a kind of rhetorical untouchable, or totem, which everybody had to endorse as our cherished first freedom. Now here's a, well, I won't make it a quick quiz, but we talk about the religion clauses, free exercise clause, as being our first freedom. It's in the First Amendment, indeed it is. But it's not actually our first freedom in that it was, the First Amendment was, the third constitutional amendment proposed to the people for ratification in 1789. Little known fact, the Bill of Rights has 10 amendments, right? The first of them is the First Amendment rights to freedom of speech and religion. The first two that were proposed in the Bill of Rights didn't pass muster. So what was proposed as the third became the first. But we've adopted freedom of religion, religious liberty, as our first freedom. And I think there's more here than a kind of way of speaking. And I think that the something more has been identified by many politicians, religious figures, and commentators throughout American history. And I think it's this. I think the view, the first view, was that religion was essential to the success of our experiment in liberty. I think this view is different. It's that religious liberty is a kind of glue or foundation, or it's often said to be the linchpin of other civil liberties. Now that's quite possibly true. Again, to put it differently, the suggestion is that religious liberty, if it's respected, taken seriously by the government, has a hydraulic effect upon the government and makes the government respect other civil liberties as well. As if to say, a country which respects and prizes religious liberty is very likely also to prize freedom of the press, freedom of speech, privacy, and other civil liberties. Now I think, I'm not sure that that's true, but I think it's quite possibly true, and we're going to find out, I think, whether it's true. Because we're no longer going to regard religious liberty as this uniquely foundational linchpin civil liberty. Lastly, a Yale theologian named George Lindbeck wrote a magisterial book about 20-something years ago called The Nature of Doctrine. And I'm not interested so much in the theological aspects of his analysis, but he said something about religious identity and communal identity that I want to offer to you, and then I'll be finished. Lindbeck said that the privatism and subjectivism that accompanies neglect of community doctrines leads to weakening of social groups that are bulwarks against an oppressive government. To translate that a little bit, Lindbeck is saying that the decline of organized religious bodies, the decline of churches, now Lindbeck didn't say this 25 years ago, but I can say, the rise of the spiritual but not religious leads to the weakening, or has to do, or amounts to the weakening of churches. Now Lindbeck makes a point about the value of having organized religious groups. Groups organized around, among other things, religious doctrines. He thinks that a religious community wrapped very tightly around a set of beliefs concerning the divine anchored civil society and provided an open space between the government and private life. That strong churches are anchors of a civil society which is not dominated by law and politics, but is not itself the private realm. In the new world I was describing earlier, the realms are public and private. Public is controlled by law. Lindbeck is saying strong churches create this huge space in our society between law and government and private life. that they create what we often call civil society. Now, I think this is very likely true, but we'll find out if it's true as we watch the churches decline even further. Now, lastly, I think this point that Lindbeck makes about the importance to civil society of strong churches, the difference that these churches make, owes to more than the distinctive moral authority that churches and religious leaders have had, although the moral authority of churches is part of what Lindbeck is talking about, but I think now that moral authority has been dissipated all too much by the churches. But the difference owes to more than the organizational and financial resources of the churches, too. Although the churches have a lot of organizational and financial resources, the difference the churches make owes also to more than the long history and strength and traditions of these churches, which hold them together through time, persisting generation after generation, and become focal points for communities' lives. I think there's something different, one more difference maker having strong churches. And I think that we in America have benefited immensely from these churches in our political and social lives. I think this is not Lindbeck, me. I think persons embedded in persisting and sometimes transnational religious communities, like the Catholic Church, I think people who are embedded in institutions like that, persisting transnational religious communities, which communities profess timeless moral truths, ultimately rooted in God's plan, so that these embedded persons see themselves as in the world, but not of the world. I think these people are way more likely to speak truth to power. And I think in American history, these people in the churches have spoken truth to power. And I think they are, these embedded people, more likely to speak truth to power than will be so many unencumbered selves, even if these unencumbered spiritual, not religious persons, consider themselves to be cosmopolitan and progressive. That the old-fashioned churches do more as social prophets and more for social justice on balance, I think, than any aggregate of spiritual but not religious people will do. Now it's time for questions. That religion is being squeezed into the framework of this big overarching liberty. So that various civil liberties, you know, freedom of choice with regard to sexual activity, freedom of choice with regard to marriage, privacy, and religion all become aspects of self-definitions. The questioner asks whether that would make it more likely or at least easier for government to suppress all of these liberties. And I think the answer is probably. And I think some of what I said, I wasn't quite intending it this way, but now that you mentioned it, I think some of the quotations that I was offering up during the course of my remarks suggest so. That is to say, just for example, if it's a matter of subjective opinion, or religion has to do with the sway of subjective opinion, which is itself not rational, not objective, isn't tethered to reality, but is about me and my identity, Now, I think the value of that project is going to appear to be limited and negotiable, and will be limited to this private sphere. So let me put that a little bit differently, and maybe track in some of the things I just said a couple of minutes ago. If religion has no public value, but all of its value is for individuals and groups in the private sphere, then without a public value, I think its value is liable to be diminished as the public's self or felt needs increase. So I do think it's not going to be quite a case of, well, given that we think religion is subjective, let's have at religion. I think rather it'll be more subtle and indirect. I fear that civil liberties, including religious liberty, will lose ground and be gobbled up more and more as what are perceived to be collective needs grow greater. So security, I mean collective security, economic prosperity, the needs of other people for privacy of information. I think that the imperatives of public projects, which again, as the story goes, are based upon objective, real reasons, will seem to be more worthy of pursuit than the private life, which is suffused by fancy and imagination. So I think that in a creeping fashion, we're liable to see an expansion of public requirements and a diminished realm of privacy and individual freedom. And I think that's part of what's going to happen with contracts with objectives, whether it's called the price of citizenship or something else. People who don't think that what the law is asking them or requiring them to do is something they can do, these people who object conscientiously to legal requirements, are going to be squashed. I think they are already being squashed, and I think they'll be squashed. And I say, at some risk of being misinterpreted, given this way of thinking about religion and public life, they probably should be squashed. Probably so. I mean, again, if it's merely the force of subjective opinion, I think it has not much power up against the needs of the community.
You didn't answer my question.
Yeah. Good.
Sorry. Good. My question was, if these are seen as subjective, like you're saying, will the government not at some point be able to define them as government-given liberties and be able to take away?
Well, that's a good point. It's a different point. Okay, that's right. Worth it. I see. I don't know about that. You know, there's a long tradition of argument in political theory about the source of rights, whether they're God-given and inalienable, whether they're natural rights, or whether rights that we have arise from the government. Sometimes that's said to be whether the rights we have are all positive rights, as if to say there aren't any rights until the government, by law, gives them to you. And I think that's a good question. I don't think I know the answer. Whether in this way of thinking, we're going to more and more think that the rights that we do have are the rights that government grants to us. That could be. Then the alternative view would be that the government doesn't grant rights, but rather recognizes natural rights and promotes natural rights. And in this latter view, which I think is a traditional view, rights are things that push back against government and limit government. Now, I think the retreat of religion from the public square will contribute to viewing rights as not natural rights, but really more matters recognized or given by the government. But I'm not sure of that. That's a good point. Yes. Good point.
My question has to do with the conscientious objectors, the butcher, the maker, the hamburger maker. But you just said you think they will be squashed in this new world.
Okay.
Do you think that any of them will attempt to, the word I'm thinking is go off grid, but form their own little society where they don't have to deal with the public sphere? They will only have to deal with the others who think like them. And we have a history of that in this country.
Yeah.
In Texas, we've got the fundamentalists, Latter-day Saints, who have gotten in trouble with the law for underage marriage and plural marriage. And in New York, they have a Jewish community on the Hudson River that, I mean, so we have a history of this. Do you think we'll see more of this kind of stuff?
I mean, that's another very good question. I'm going to take a liberty in interpreting it as whether given the prospects that I described, which are dim, if not grim, will more people try to go off the grid? Now, I live in Indiana now, and what comes to mind immediately, not fundamentalist of the sort you're describing, but the Amish. In the way that the Amish live off the grid. The answer to that is, I think, yes, we'll see an uptick in that kind of withdrawal. Insular communities, I think we'll see an uptick. But I do think also these two things. One, I think, as I said, you've been prompted, you can't hide from the government now. I think it's very hard to go off the grid. I mean, you can go off the you can be less on the grid than yesterday, but to go off the grid is very hard. The government will find you. The NSA is probably listening to you. Yes, it's all true.
So, but those with the Amish are, and they willingly pay their taxes, but they don't participate.
Correct. So I think you'll see more people going on. But the other thing is this, I think maybe so. Now I would still say, as you probably can anticipate, that it's not a good government or a just government ought not to put people to the choice of either participating more or less normally, let's say, in public life, but at the price of giving up your conscience. That the choice is conformity or withdrawal. Now, I don't think that that's a just government's approach to things, but it seems to be, you know, the wave of the future. And I should add, this is beyond your question, I don't think this is settled. My task is to describe a way of looking at things, a set of convictions, a worldview, call it what you want, which is not my construction, it's not a fantasy. And I certainly don't mean to be like talking like a novelist. I think it's already there, but I don't mean to suggest, and I don't wish to be heard to say that the consequences are inevitable, that this thing can't be arrested, the effects can't be stymied. But I do wish to describe this pattern or worldview, call it different things, you know, the orthodox are orthodox for therapeutic reasons, that view, or religion is identity, but that's what I've been talking about. I think it's helpful, or try to be helpful, by saying this is the view that's already gained more than a toehold on our large imagination. And there are reasons to think it'll continue to grow and even flourish. But knowing its dimensions and seeing what its consequences are likely to be could arouse people to push back. And that's really, it's not that I have a message of optimism, which I don't think I do, but rather to say, I mean, I say what I say in order to encourage people to push back, or at least so that everybody can see a little better where we stand, and then decide whether they want to push back. But I don't think the consequences, I say squash or people going Amish, I don't think it's inevitable, but I do think that if we do nothing, it will happen.
We're going to take two more questions, but before we take them, I just want to make two brief announcements. First of all, there's still food out there. Your food out on the way out. Secondly, the Remnant Trust exhibit, which is opening tomorrow at the museum, there will be a reception, and I invite any of you who would like to come to that. It starts at 7 o'clock, Museum of Texas Tech, coming on the west side. There will be more opportunities to talk with Jerry and see the wonderful Remnant Trust exhibit. So, I'm going to have one question here, and then one other. And whoever picks the most will have a chance. Let's have a question.
One more question with respect to this idea of just akin to that notion of recovery. I'm wondering if, after the loss of the term, the loss of the idea of dogma, is really what you're referring to these people that ability to have strength to push back, because they have something they know is objectively true. We have things like Babylon 2, but we have the rise of neo-charismatic groups in the United States. And what Christian Smith talks about is the moralistic therapeutic deism that takes place, that his sister says it's all personal. So wouldn't the recovery of this be more likely placed at the hands of the churches who say, we give up this individualistic kind of idea about religion and spirituality and go back to dogma? How much would that help out with that?
Well, I think it would. And it's a very rich set of comments. Let me pick up on one or two things that you said and amplify them. But I agree with almost everything, or maybe everything you said. One, you didn't quite say, but I'm hinting at it. I don't think the society, that America will be able to recover its proper sense of religion, religious liberty, without churches that is believers pushing very hard. I mean, this what I'm about to say may be a little bit simplistic, and like, maybe I've sanded off the edges a little bit too much.
Yeah.
But I don't think the outcome can be much better than the outcome the churches try to bring about. If the churches don't lead and don't show the way, it seems to be quite unlikely that non-believers, spiritual but not religious people, mere politicians, mere judges, I don't see that they're going to get this right and buy into it with the political and moral courage it will take to see it through, unless the churches are really requiring them or trying to require them. And your guess is at least as good as mine, and probably better, as to what we can expect from the churches. You know, I'm Catholic, and I think the performance of my own church on these matters has been maybe passable, but not outstanding. And anybody can see the Catholic beliefs of the Catholic Church, the clergy has lost a great deal of its moral authority by self-inflicted wounds, not because of anything Obama's ever said, but because of the sex abuse crisis and a failure to lead morally. So that's a long-winded way of saying I'm not sure about the church is what they'll do. But I do think that dogma is important, and not, I hesitate to say this because it sounds sort of impious, but rather not for its own sake. But as I was indicating all too briefly in a clipped way, we're talking about Lindbeck at the end, think about dogma. Now dogma is about, I guess the evidence of things unseen. It's about invisible realities. But dogma purports to talk about realities, spiritual realities to be sure, divine realities, but realities. And a group of people who adhere to dogma or profess dogma or respect dogma are almost certainly going to be people rooted in and owing their final allegiance to a greater than human source of meaning and value. They're going to be people, as I so quickly described, consider themselves citizens of the world, in the world, but not of it. They're going to be people who can speak truth to power. Now, dogma itself, whether you profess this creed or that creed, you might say, that's sort of politically inert. How is that going to get people geared up to fight for civil rights? Well, okay, but people who are organizing their church lives and therefore themselves around dogma, that's another way of saying, or their adherence to dogma is a sure sign that they believe in God. And they believe that this world is not the final resting place. I think those people, as I was suggesting with Lindbeck's help, have been in American history, could be now, emboldened to speak truth to power. I realize I'd be maybe among the first to say, as I did say to some extent during my remark, the American churches have certainly proved to be fallible. A lot of the oppression of Native Americans and LDS people was promoted by other Christians, especially Protestant Christians. That's all true. But I do say, as I said at the beginning, the American story about religious liberty is by and large, a screaming success. And by and large, the churches have proved, in season and out of season, to be leaders of social reforms. Some didn't do too well, like prohibition, but many others, like abolition, the civil rights movement, the peace movements during my time in college, were, I think, basically on the right track, and they were really led by churches. So I think the churches are a great social asset, and the loss of identity or identification with churches, hence with dogma, I think, as Lindbeck suggests, really just weakens and causes political conviction to atrophy. So, to put it very plainly, we'll move on to the next question. I think in a world in which people are told citizenship means compromise, not conscience, that's not good news. It is not. I consider that to be very bad news indeed. If you want to be a citizen, you have to compromise, and your conscience is what you're compromising. Well, that's a pretty, I don't know if this is the right use of the term conservative. That's a very conservative viewpoint. I know it's an insult to Steve Balch, conservative friend of mine, but that's what the establishment wants to say. The man wants you to believe, if you want to be in public life, you have to do what we say, not what you think God requires.
So what's the difference, I'm going to see it, between legalized discrimination and these religious bill laws that we've seen in North Carolina?
Could you just say a little more, if you wouldn't mind, or repeat maybe a little bit.
What's the difference between these religious bill laws being passed in Virginia and North Carolina and just basically being legalized discrimination.
Okay. Does anybody hear it? So the bill is referencing North Carolina, and there are other places too, Georgia, Indiana had a failed attempt to do something like this last March. And, you know, is it really just legalized discrimination? Well, I think the answer is no. I don't think that's true. There are two reasons I'll mention why I don't think that's true. I don't think in any of these arguments, political battles, legislative imbroglios that we could talk about, North Carolina, et cetera, as far as I can tell, none of these bills, and I don't think the people involved promoting these bills, have a view something like this. We, proponents of these bills, think it would be fine that people ought to have the legal right simply to say, I'm not going to serve, make a cake for counsel, someone who's gay. I've never heard of anybody saying that. Maybe somebody has said it, but I haven't heard of it. These are all about whether the law will force unwilling people to do something they regard to be immoral. Namely, assist at a same-sex wedding, or perform an abortion, or whatever the example happens to be. So, when the law is proposing to force someone to do something that they believe to be morally impossible for them to do, the first way that comes to my mind is not licensing that person to discriminate. Rather, I think what comes to mind is this. Second, rejecting, a starting point where the way it's set up is the law, in order to protect against discrimination, would require everybody to do X. And that's what non-discrimination requires. Some people want to not do X. They want to get away with something, so we're just letting them discriminate. I think that's actually the wrong way to think about this. I think the better way to think about all these issues, like the wedding cake maker and all that kind of stuff, is like this. There are a lot of people involved who have interests and values, and their views can deserve to be considered with respect and in charity. There are people who are same-sex attracted and want to marry, the law permits that. There are people who have objections to that kind of activity, they don't want to be made to be part of it. That the law ought to take into account all the persons who will be affected by what the law will be, and all of their interests and what their values are, and try to find a way to accommodate the most of those values, which I think is the way to go about making law in any situation. So the way I would suggest we think of it is not licensing discrimination, but rather respecting conscience. And with regard to these kinds of controversies, I would say, especially since, as far as I'm aware, in these cases of wedding cake maker, photographer and stuff, I don't think there's been a case where any same-sex couple who wanted to marry was unable to secure a service, you know, whether it's a wedding cake or a florist. That there were in places where even if this Christian person says, I can't do that, that there would be somebody to fulfill the service. So I think that's the way it has shaped up, at least in the cases I've seen. So then the situation is where a same-sex couple who wants to marry can get the services they want without intruding on anybody else's conscience. Is it just, you know, correct for the law to say, well, we'll nonetheless require people to either act in violation of their conscience or abandon that line of work? Now, to me, that's the choice that people are put to. If I want to stay in the wedding photography business, I'm going to have to do something that I can't do. So I'll have to get out of that business. Now, I don't know if that's discrimination or not, but I think that is unjust. To say to people, the price of you being in the business is to violate your conscience. And we don't care if the service you would provide could be provided seamlessly by somebody else. We're still going to make you provide it to these people. I think that's unjust. And I don't think that's a matter of discrimination. But discrimination, I think, is discrimination against, in these cases, Christians. Okay.
Okay.
Thank you very much.